Here at 1600 Polymnia Street in New Orleans, Louisiana, it's kind of hard to imagine what this place once was. A car park and a mechanic shop, but in World War II, over 30,000 people here built over 20,000 ships. They were known as the Higgins boats, and they were designed by Andrew Higgins of New Orleans. During an interview with Eisenhower, the historian Stephen Ambrose recalls Eisenhower saying that these boats won the war for them. Because of Andrew Higgins' contributions to the war effort, the National World War II Museum is located right here in New Orleans, Louisiana. His boats allowed for hundreds and hundreds of thousands of men to go on to invasions all across Europe, and particularly in Normandy. The Germans would have expected our men to go into docks, and many of them would be killed. But very few expected hundreds of thousands to come on beaches all across Europe, and that's really what won the war. I'm now standing on Omaha Beach, where somewhere around 71 years ago this month, men from all around the United States fighting in the 29th Infantry Division fought on this beach for the freedom of another people. And unfortunately, that fight came at a cost, and many Americans died that day. But in the end, they successfully took this part of Normandy and eventually made it all the way to Berlin.
Until just before the invasion of Normandy, most Americans had no idea of the fight to come. Some were nervous about what they were about to embark on, but nevertheless, their spirits kept up. On June 6, 1944, after a large-scale bombing attack, as well as airborne assault, the first waves of Allied troops hit the beaches of Normandy. There were over 160,000 of them, 73,000 of which were American, but by the end of the day, there were over 6,600 American casualties.
Just imagine tons and tons of guys being seasick, coming early in the morning onto a beach, onto an invasion that they had not heard of only a few hours before, to fight for something that many of them were drafted, many of them signed up to fight for, but didn't have great odds of surviving or making it out of this invasion, fought on this open beach.
The V1 bombs, Doodlebugs, or Buzz bombs were launched not far from here against London. This was one of Hitler's Wunderwaffen, the super weapon that all the Nazis had promised. It was scary at first because the Allies had nothing to defend against these forerunners to the modern-day cruise missile. This was a terror weapon, but the Allies managed to set up artillery batteries on the coast to shoot them down, even sending airplanes to do the job. But inevitably, some of them got through to their target. Here one lands in the London area, causing considerable damage.
Point du Hoc, where I stand now, was one of the strategic points in the German fortifications of Normandy.
Of 225 Rangers that left the ships the first wave to attack Point du Hoc, only 90 men were still able to bear arms by the time a relief force arrived on the morning of June 8th. In the large battle, the 2nd and 5th Ranger battalions suffered 96 killed, 183 wounded, and 32 missing during the battle for Point du Hoc in Omaha Beach.
Standing here, it's just incredible to see all of this, at least 71 years old. And it sort of is a testament to the way that Germans were able to build their battery and fortifications along the coast. It's amazing that even though it was bombed and attacked and came upon by Americans, it's still in amazing shape.
After a visit to the beaches of Normandy and Point du Hoc, we then went to the D-Day Museum.
This is an M10 tank destroyer, also commonly used during the Second World War. This particular one was built by Fisher Body in Detroit, Michigan.
After we finished seeing some of the physical remnants of the war, we visited the American Cemetery and paid tribute to the many who never had the chance to come home and grow old. Among those buried here are the two sons of President Theodore Roosevelt, one of whom died as a pilot in the First World War, and the second who was killed not far from the beaches of Normandy. After a visit to the beaches of Normandy, Pointe du Hoc, and museums around there, we took a drive to Bastogne, Belgium, to see where the 101st Airborne, along with other divisions, fought and won the Battle of the Bulge.
This is the command structure of the 101st during around the time that the Battle of the Bulge was taking place. Major General Taylor was in command. He'd later become a four-star general and chairman of the Joint Chiefs for Kennedy. And then below him was Brigadier General McAuliffe, who sent the famous telegram to the German commander once they asked for the surrender of the Americans.
In the former 101st Airborne Headquarters, now a museum, we saw many lifelike scenes depicting all kinds of stories from World War II. Although they did seem a bit odd, they did give a sense of what it must have been like.
Fitz Esperanza was one of the many men fighting with the 101st in Bastogne, and this book, Nuts, is his autobiography. To read from it, on page 49, he writes about the famous incident with General McAuliffe and the German commander. He writes, "The bad weather continued, foggy, clouded days and snowy nights. It meant no air support, no food, and ammunition was getting real low. The German attacks were relentless, day and night probing all parts of the perimeter. But the 101st continued to tell them to go to hell. In fact, when the Germans sent a delegation under a white flag of truce asking us to surrender, General McAuliffe's reply was, 'Nuts.' And that confused the Germans because they didn't know what nuts meant, which made it even funnier for the Americans." Here I am at the American Cemetery and Memorial in Luxembourg, and I'm going to take you around to a few of the graves to see some of the many thousands of people buried here. You can see that there are a few amongst many Jewish graves here, and it really goes to show that America was such a diverse nation of many faiths and cultures, and they all came together to fight for this war. I'm now standing in front of General George S. Patton's grave. He was known for his command of the 3rd U.S. Army during World War II, but little know that after the war he was fatally injured in a car crash on his way to go hunting with a fellow general.
On April 12, 1945, the 9th U.S. Army crossed the Elbe River near Magdeburg, some 50 miles from the German capital. They established a second bridgehead farther south on the following day. German counterattacks forced them to withdraw from the northern position on the 14th, but the Americans held the southern bridgehead. Many observers have concluded that only a political decision, perhaps made weeks earlier, could have held Dwight D. Eisenhower's forces at the Elbe. Careful examination of the Supreme Commander's action indicates that he halted his troops short of Berlin and Prague for military reasons only.
Here I am at the German Reichstag. It's the equivalent of the United States Senate, and it's where most of the major German decisions are made for the country and for its people. And this building was originally burnt down by the Germans in the Second World War, but here it was mostly redone, and today there's a restaurant and a giant dome and a lot of artwork from a lot of famous German artists displayed inside of it. I'm inside the dome on top of the German Parliament. This dome was built by Sir Norman Foster upon the reunification of Germany, and it symbolizes how viewable the German Parliament is. You can look inside from down below, or even get a peek from here at sessions currently going on.
The Reichstag was the venue of several of Hitler's long and virulent speeches, most notably January 30, 1939, when he warned that the outbreak of the war would mean the end of the European Jews. It's eerie now to walk here above that same space and know how prophetic these words were to prove. It is estimated that over 300,000 houses were destroyed and 40% of the population dispersed by the Allied bombing. In Berlin, the scars are everywhere to see, even in this flea market in the Tiergarten. There are very few signs of Hitler's Berlin in the capital. One of the few to exist are these lampposts which line most of the main streets in central Berlin. They were designed by Albert Speer, Hitler's favorite architect and also the war minister. He also designed the Chancellery and was tried at the Nuremberg trials and imprisoned for life for his wartime crimes. I'm standing right outside the town of Oranienburg, at a concentration camp just 20 miles away from Berlin. where many, many people died during World War II. And above me is a sign that, once translated into English, is the greatest lie ever told. It says that if you work, you will be free. And they told that to all the prisoners that came here. And of course, it wasn't true. Two to 300,000 people died here, and many of them are buried in these mass graves, lined one after another with a pale, simple-looking piece of concrete on top. I was just reading some of the many stories that they have here, and one of them had to do with the wall around the perimeter here. Some of the SS soldiers, to get entertainment for themselves, they would take the hat off of one of the Jewish inmates, and they'd throw it over and tell the inmate to go get it. And eventually, after yelling at them enough, they would try to go get it, and on their way up, the Germans would shoot them, and later say that they caught someone in the act of escaping. Because once they caught someone in the act of escaping and shot them dead, they would get extra leave, cigarettes, and a beer. The Nazis began shooting people down here, but then once more prisoners came, they realized it wasn't a very productive way of to killing the many and many people that eventually came to this camp. So they moved them to the gas chambers. Here I'm standing in the crematorium. Once more and more prisoners came, they just didn't have room to bury their bodies. So they put them in here and turned them to ash. Just being here and walking around really makes me think that there's no better example of why we fought, why we sent most of our troops to Europe, than this place right here, seeing what happened. I'm standing right now where Hitler's bunker was during his reign of Nazi Germany. During the end of the war, he moved his chancellery right here, where it'd be safe from the incoming Russian forces and the continuous Allied bombing above. On the morning of April 30th, 1945, Hitler committed suicide in this very spot and ordered his body to be burned so that the Allied forces would not get a hold of it. That marked the end of World War II, a war which began for many countries and many different places, but all ended in this very spot of Berlin, right here where I'm standing. Now a car park and apartments. It doesn't seem much like it was back then, but there's still a feeling of the presence here during that part of the war. I'm walking in front of what is now the German Finance Ministry, but at one point was the center of the Luftwaffe. All orders for all planes and bombers commanded by them came from this very building. Now it seems to stand as a memorial and a place of remembrance for the uprising in the 1950s, but it has a much darker history in World War II. It was in this exact building where the planned invasion of Britain was drawn up, codenamed Operation Sea Lion. On July 16, 1940, Hitler issued Führer Directive No. 16, which set in motion preparations for the invasion of Britain. In these walls, he stated that the RAF would have been beaten down in morale such that it can no longer display any aggressive force in opposition to a German invasion. Thankfully, that invasion never took place after the Luftwaffe was essentially defeated over the skies of southern England. Yet it's interesting to think that if it had succeeded, then the whole war might have come to a grinding halt well before the United States had a chance to get involved after the Japanese attack at Pearl Harbor on December 7th, 1941. I'm standing in front of the Brandenburg Gate, which is one of the most recognizable symbols in Germany, more particularly Berlin. But at the end of World War II, Germany and France and many other nations were destroyed, both financially and physically. But through the help of the Marshall Plan, France, Germany, and many other countries in Europe were able to rebuild to become the powerful democratic nations that they are today. We're back now in New Orleans, Louisiana, the National World War II Museum's Victory Garden. During and after World War II, nearly 20 million of these gardens were built all across the United States to provide food for the people at the home and also to be sent to the troops abroad. Thank you for coming along with us on this trip across Europe from Normandy all the way to Berlin.
We hope you enjoyed your time, and we'll take just a second to think about the many men and women who fought and some gave their lives for our freedom.
Gefühlt, wenn ihr heute nicht spielt, dass ich alles versäume.